I've always been shy. Confess that I'm shy. Can't you get to this confident air in the mask that I wear, cause I'm shy. And you may be sure, way down deep I'm demure. Though some people I know might deny it, at bottom I'm quiet and pure. I'm aware that it's wrong to be meek as I am. My chances may pass me by, I pretend to be strong. But as weak as I am, all I can do is try. Get soups, I try.
Outspoken memoirs of Mary Rodgers, copies of which will be available for sale and signing after this chat. Jesse was still a kid when he began to sing the praises, or at least the musical phrases, of Mary Rodgers, daughter of Broadway's and Hollywood's star composer Richard Rodgers. He was in the chorus of the summer camp's production of Once Upon a Mattress, about which you have heard. Became Mary's only Broadway hit, now much revived around the country, for which she did write the music, and most notably for SHY. Green also played the show's male lead, Prince Dauntless, in high school. He also appeared in Far From Broadway stagings of her daddy's hits, Oklahoma and South Pacific. Later, with a year degree in English and theater, Green worked on and around Broadway as a gopher, a copyist, musical coordinator, and then he wrote about theater and other subjects for the Arts and Leisure section of the Times, for New York Magazine, and for the Times Sunday Magazine before being named to his current post and doing away with his predecessor. Green has also written both fiction and nonfiction books, including The Velveteen Father, An Unexpected Journey to Parenthood, praised as an intimate and witty account of his transformation from gay Greenwich Village single to Brooklyn family man with a husband and two adopted sons. They all enjoyed visiting Mary Rodgers' house in Quag on Long Island, where she referred to her conservative neighbors as Quagladites. Green first approached Mary and her second husband, Hank Gettle, for help in writing a profile of their composer's son, Adam, now also the Tony winner, and found them a shockingly free-flowing font of inside stories. Later, he sought out her input on a piece about the stage and screenwriter, Arthur Lorenz, to whom in the book she repeatedly refers to as the little shit, as can many in show business, I found. But about whom she replied, now famously, call me when he's dead. And yet along the way, Mary made Lorenz Adam's godfather. Maybe Mr. Green can explain that contradiction to us. Finally, Mary came to Jesse for help writing the memoirs, for which she had a contract, but only on and off confidence and commitment. It took about a decade to turn their 2 years of freewheeling conversations into this unique memoir, a dialogue between her snarky memories and his wise and witty footnotes and comments, adding context, confirmation, contradiction, one downright disagreement. SHY is the funniest book that the East Hampton Star ever sent me a review, and printed all the naughty words. And maybe you'll get to hear some of them now from Jesse Green himself. Thanks again for doing this. Again, and despite the title, everyone who's read this book finds it anything but shy. This sounds too loud to me. But what about Mary herself? Was she as snarky as her memoirs from birth? Actually like the princess overcompensating for innate shyness? Or was it a natural reaction to the intimidating world of showbiz stardom in which she grew up?
Well, Claire could tell us to sing that song, to sing the word shy. It's an octave leap. There's no way to sing it shyly. The song forces you to embrace that contradiction. And Mary was that contradiction. Everything you say is true. She did not present as shy. In fact, as I mentioned and you recall, when I first met her and Hank and went to their apartment to talk about their son, Adam, I was kind of shocked by how much they were willing to tell me. And I kept saying, yeah, maybe. I'm not usually the one who's censoring the source, but I felt like, you know, you're going a little too far. Maybe you shouldn't be telling me these things. And to top it all off, as I left, they produced a dossier of documents, report cards and apology letters and bills and things like that. And Hank put it in a nice manila envelope, so I should be easily able to take them. They were, as I call them, radically or knee-jerk transparent. And I think that was a reaction, not against a kind of innate shyness, but against a terrible repression that she grew up living among. And it surprised me. I had heard, as many of us know, that Rodgers was a cold fish and a drinker and a womanizer, and that her mother, Dorothy Rodgers, who was a decorator and an inventor and a very clever woman, was also no bundle of warmth. But I didn't understand just how much the family situation kept the daughters, and particularly Mary, who was a rebel and called herself rotten from the start, kept them suppressed and unable to speak or exemplify their actual personhood. And so when the minute she got a chance to get out from under that, while still maintaining a financial connection, she did. And the rest is history. She would never not answer a question except for one.
We'll get to that. The book's dialogue format was something of a gift from the mother Mary so long felt so remote. Remind us, when you just have, who Dorothy Rodgers was, but how they ultimately made peace and collaborated in print.
Well, they collaborated in print. I don't know about the making peace part. I don't think that ever really happened. She made peace with her father. And she was able to do that, even though, you know, objectively, he was perhaps a worse parent. But she was able to make peace with him because of the gift of his music. And in the end, that's what she heard. When she thought of him, she heard those songs. Which, you know, imagine, you're a little girl, and you're in the bedroom upstairs, and downstairs your father is writing those Rodgers and Hart tunes, and worrying about, are they good enough? It's astonishing. And, you know, when she met Sondheim at Oscar Hammerstein's farm in Bucks County, it was because, she believes, her father was there for the weekend working on Carousel with Aki, as she called him. So she was able to forgive him. But her mother, although she didn't forgive, she did stick with her. And they did things together, including in the 70s writing a book called A Word to the Wives. And in this book, it sort of grew out of an advice column they did, that the idea of which was to contrast the responses of women of two different generations to current day problems. You know, things like, oh, my son wants to bring his fiance to stay for the weekend, do I let them stay in the same room? And then you would get the two different women's answers, but what they would do is, it was printed in such a way that Mary's answers were in red type and Dorothy's answers were in black, and that was the clue as we started working to a way we might work. She wanted the whole book to actually be in dialogue, and I refused that.
Well, the book is anything but stiff-necked, but the reader becomes so from going up and down and up and down to the footnotes, because they're not, here's where it's to look in the future, but it's his immediate answer to what she said.
But let me just say that the reason I did that, I mean, the notes were supposed to be along the side of each page, not along the bottom. But it was expensive to produce. Every page would have had to have been designed individually. We'll save that for the chapbook version that comes out. But the idea for me was, what should this book be? Well, everyone who knew Mary just loved to hear her talk, loved to hear her laugh, loved the way she connected ideas from 60 years ago, not in a demented sort of way, but really making profound connections. And I wanted to preserve that. That's what was my main goal. I had read her attempts to write some of this, and ironically, it did not sound like her at all. So I had to figure out how to write her voice that she couldn't do. And it certainly wasn't going to be a voice that was saying, "My father, Richard Rodgers, the great American composer." Like, she said, "Daddy." That's all she said. I mean, she said, or even, you know, whoever she was talking about, Betty Comden. She wasn't going to pause to explain to you who Betty Comden was. And so it became clear that I had to be in there and yet not get in the way of the voice. So that's how the idea came to be.
As a kid, Mary fancied that Oscar Aki Hammerstein would have made a better dad. But as a songwriter herself years later, she preferred, as I do, the lyrics of Rodgers' first collaborator, Tiny Troubled Lorenz Larry Hart. Talk about what she had to say about each of those two word guys.
Well, Sondheim said famously, and drove a stake into both families when he did so, that Rodgers was a man of infinite talent and limited soul, and Hammerstein was a man of limited talent and infinite soul. Understand that Hammerstein was Sondheim's mentor and basically saved him and created him as the person he grew up to be. But, you know, and I think it's a harsh judgment, but Sondheim was looking at lyrics like, you know, "praying like a lark," and all, you know, "does a lark pray?" I mean, why is that happening in America?
She said that.
I mean, they were very close friends, and they agreed on a lot of that stuff. And she said, "Wouldn't it have been more fun if that, you know, if they prayed like a narc or something like that?" But but she also objected to the sanctification of Oscar Hammerstein, whom she liked and who was very kind to her, but he was no saint. The idea that he and Rodgers represented, you know, the good one and the bad one, certainly Rodgers represented the bad one. But Oscar wasn't such a saint. And, you know, he had a long-term affair with this woman, Temple, Texas, who Mary points out is not a congregation in Houston. and was a kind of negligent father himself, although not really a cruel one the way Richard Rodgers was. I mean, Richard Rodgers called Mary an ape, and she was too fat and to stop smiling. Nobody wanted to see her smile. Your laugh is too loud. I mean, basically anything she did was too much for a very refined, self-created, refined gentleman like Richard Rodgers.
And I got the feeling that Larry Hart was almost a playmate. I mean, he was a problematic person, but he was her size.
Yes, and there's various stories about how he would try to escape. He called Rodgers the principal, and Rodgers called him the shrimp. And there's some stories about how he sort of tried to escape from Rodgers' claws. You know, admittedly, Rodgers wanted him to work. You know, they had songs to write, and he was always avoiding that, or perhaps avoiding the composer. And so he would go off with Mary to the treehouse sometimes. But she adored him. When her own parents would not pick her up from school when she was sick, they would send for Larry.
So what were her favorite Hart and Hammerstein lyrics?
Little Boy Blue. He was too good to me. What is the name of that song? He was too good to me. Thank you. I think that one was her favorite. She had the handwritten pencil manuscript of it, sat on a music stand in her living room the whole time we were working.
And Hammerstein and Lawrence weren't playing?
When Lawrence weren't, well, she liked, in Oklahoma, she very much liked the one that's always cut, Lonely Room, that Judd sings. It's an amazing dramatic moment. She liked The Gentleman is a Dope, which was the most Rodgers and Hart of the Rodgers and Hammerstein songs. And she loved Carousel. I mean, other than The Mountain, you know, Climbing the Mountain, just no. She would actually cut it.
So the Richard-Dorothy relationship was shaped in part by his drinking and by more than just an eye for other ladies, of which she was well aware. You have a footnote about that involving a new sports car that my wife hates for me to repeat, so please, you do it.
Oh, I couldn't possibly without seeing it. Do you have it written down?
Well, I can recite it.
Basically, the gist of it is, supposedly, he had a new sports car and he couldn't figure out where to put the key. He was looking for the thing. And she says to him, if it had hair around it, you'd find it.
I didn't say it. And Mary once found herself drying the tears of one of her dad's discarded playmates. Tell us that story.
I have no idea what that story is. Did I write that?
It was in Philadelphia, I guess. She was in the...
Yes. Well, so they were...
It's good one of us to meet.
Yeah, really. Well, it's been a while. It was Hotspot.
Right.
It was Philadelphia. She was in town with Hotspot, and one of the chorus girls got sick, and she went to visit her to see if she could do anything. And yes, that's what she was like. She would do that, as Claire's story told you. I mean, she was really extremely thoughtful and giving.
And that's what the girl was crying about. She had just been...
Well, Mary didn't realize that, but the girl told her that it was because her father had just dumped her. That's a nice little scene.
It seemed to me that seeing big Broadway shows when her parents finally permitted it was not as key to her lifelong love for the theater as her own experience at summer stock and out of town. So talk about that, and particularly the times at Tamiman in Pennsylvania's Pocono Mountains, what she did, with whom, and how it affected her.
I do want to say that seeing Carousel changed her life. Because it was part of the beginning of her understanding her father. He could not say or do for her what the music and the story was able to do. After all, it is a story about a man who cannot show love to his wife and daughter and comes back from death to try to do so and fucks that up too. There, you got a dirty word. And yet is forgiven. That's very controversial today, that forgiveness that the mother and daughter offer to the abuser. But as Mary used to say, you know, it's not a documentary. It's not a moral tract. It's about real lives. It's about what happens in people's lives. But that said, yes, like many of you in this room, in whatever your fields are, but particularly those who are in the arts, it happens when you're a young person among other people trying to do the same thing. That's when you get hooked, and the beauty of it and the torture of it all comes home. And she certainly experienced it all. Some of it was at Westport, as we've heard. She did lose her virginity on a mattress backstage, ironic, once upon a mattress. But it was more than once upon a mattress. She had been asking her parents to let her go to Westport for several years, and they thought she was too young, and frankly, they thought she would get involved with exactly what she did get involved with when she got there. And who was the first person she saw when she arrived for the summer but Steve Sondheim working in the box office or something that day. They formed, that group of people formed the kind of intense bond if you don't have it at that age, you can never have it. And as far as Tamiman, when Tamiman, maybe many of you know, was originally a labor, I don't want to say labor camp, that sounds wrong. It was a camp run by maybe the International Ladies Garment Workers, or anyway, a union, for summer relief from the city for their workers, and it grew into a kind of Lonely Hearts social summer club for singles from the city. And they provided entertainment for them. And so there was a very well-known entertainment division to this place. And Mary was brought there by Marshall Bearer, her frequent lyricist, often called, well, someone in the book calls her, calls him one of the greatest of all lyricists and one of the worst of all house guests. read all about him. So they went there and they had to turn out review songs for the first half of the summer. They're just writing throwaway songs for reviews. But in the second half of the summer, they were allowed to consider, if they wanted, trying to write a book musical. And Marshall Bearer had this idea, had been toying with this idea for years of a modern update, kind of sarcastic, slightly before Mad Magazine, but Mad Magazine-ish take on The Princess and the Pea. And they wrote it in 3 weeks. And it was written sort of backwards because they had to, the guy who ran the place, whose name really was Moab Hack, said, you have to use my 9 principal players. You know, so there were 9 who were like paid more than the others. And you have to give them all leading roles. So, you know, they sort of worked backward from, well, one of them really couldn't move. So that one was given a non-moving role, and one of them had a, just like, couldn't remember lines, so he became the mute king, and et cetera. And it turned out to be genius, because there's 9 principal roles with different talents engaged. Every high school in America, you know, wants to have more leading roles and roles for someone who can't dance, someone who can't remember lines, someone who can't sing high or low. So it was perfect. So they wrote it. It was a, you know, just 2 performances. I think they had a reprise of it the next week. And then George Abbott came aboard for Broadway. Well, off Broadway first, and then Broadway.
So how did a princess of show business, with her father's fame and her own early backstage experience, end up writing advertising jingles, songs, and stories for children, including the surprising success of body-switching Freaky Friday in print and on screen?
Yeah, well, you've left out the Rin Tin Tin songs.
Right.
She did clarify that they were not for the dog to sing. They were sung about the dog. The Prince Spaghetti song, you may remember that. That stuff was what you do when you start out. You do anything, and particularly if you're Richard Rodgers' daughter and you're trying to kind of stay away from his part of the field, which was almost all of the field. So she found herself a little more comfortable, or perhaps being pigeonholed as a woman and as a young mother, with children's stories, animal stories, commercials, and things like that. And she just wanted to make money from her own work, instead of living off her parents. You know, it's hard to call it largesse. There were so many strings. It was more like being, you know, handed a lasagna. But anyway, does lasagna have strings? I don't even understand that metaphor. The cheese. Yes, thank you. You can edit my next book. But so she found that niche for herself, and in a way, you know, Once Upon a Mattress was similar. It's a children's story that has been revamped with a semi-adult personality. But in terms of what happened, that she had these 2 other amazing careers besides musical theater, the thing that she felt was that she had a lot of arrows in her quiver, she said. And if one didn't work, if after many years, you know, of trying, Hotspot was a miserable failure. Another show, she was working on a musical adaptation of The Member of the Wedding, and it got ruined in rights problems, as many shows do. She had other things that she could do, or she thought she would enjoy. So she tried writing a children's book, and
Well, about children's music. She was asked to write songs for children, and then
She worked with Leonard Bernstein on the Young People's Concerts the entire time he did it. She was one of the writers with him, I mean, for him, on that. So she was strongly identified with it, but she started writing children's books because she wanted to correct the ideas that children get about what they're supposed to be, that are told by their parents and also told by children's books of that era. So her first children's book was called The Rotten Book, and it was about a rotten kid. and much who does many of the things that Mary actually did in her childhood. Although never, I don't think that child ever starts a fire to see what will happen to the organza curtains, which she did. So she did that, and the Freaky Friday series was unbelievably successful. It's still, you know, it's still very successful. It's never been out of print. It's been remade several times as movies and musicals. And then she was sort of, that wasn't going where she wanted it to after a number of years, and she moved on to her next career as a philanthropist and board member in educational institutions, and she became, as many of you know, the chairman of Juilliard for many years, and was a huge success at that. Not necessarily with the fundraising. She couldn't, she didn't understand how zeros worked in math, or in life, for that matter. She really did not see if something was $100,000 or $1,000. It was very unclear to her. So she was not on the money side of the chairmanship of Juilliard, but she was an incredible leader for the students and for the image of the institution.
And for all that, the award they gave her had something to do with a water fountain.
No, she said that. She said they made you give your name to something. You have to put your name on it because it supposedly encourages other people to give money. And she didn't want to put her name on it. And she said, I don't even know what it is. It's a water fountain somewhere up on the 90,000th floor. It isn't. I went and looked. It's a nice enough plaque for a whole suite of rooms that's, that was actually quite accessible. She never saw it. She didn't want to go.
And how did she change Juilliard? I mean, there are lots of quotes about the changes she made. Give us a sense of, what it was that she brought to Juilliard and how it changed.
Well, she created the playwriting program, or she helped create it with Marsha Norman and Christopher Durang. I actually am not quite sure if she created it, but she funded it finally to the level it needed to be, so that it became one of the leading playwriting training programs in the country. That's just an example. But she met the students. Like, that hadn't been something people thought of doing before, to the point where they adored her. They would, when at every convocation, she would come out and they would chant, Mary, Mary, Mary. She was, in the same way that she was reflexively transparent, she was reflexively approachable, and particularly by young people. She just adored helping talent move forward.
Okay, here we go. During and after her first marriage, Mary seems to admit that bed too often seemed the proper or improper repayment for a swell dinner. So talk about how she viewed her romantic interludes and about some of the showbiz celebrities so repaid or repelled.
Oh my God. Well, this was key to her, actually. I mean, it's funny and the stories are, perfectly amusing and all that, but the truth is, she was, when her first marriage ended, and it was a sad ending to a very difficult marriage, she was still quite a young woman, now with three children. And she did not feel that there was impossible to be unmarried in that situation. So she went, as does Princess Winifred in Once Upon a Mattress, on a search for a mate. But she had never had the benefit of women of an earlier generation telling her what that's about. What matters? How do you do it? What does it mean to be a young woman who's interested in sex in a society that was not interested in letting you do that? If you're from a certain slice of society. So in writing the book, there were many times when I said, Mary, do you really want to talk about when you slept with that person? Now, this is between her marriages. And she said, yes, this is why she did not allow her children to have access in any way to the book till it was finished. They were not to read it until it was done. She wanted everything in it, except the few things she didn't, because she didn't want to recapitulate the problem that she had faced as a young woman who had very little information. So, My point is, for both good reasons and bad reasons, including lack of self-esteem, but also curiosity, healthy young sex drive, and why shouldn't she, was her point. She met lots of men, she experimented, tried to figure out what mattered to her. And as you, if any of you knew Hank, her second husband, it turned out what mattered to her was someone who made her laugh, someone she felt shared a sensibility with, and who was, you know, passably attractive. He was actually quite handsome, but she said that. And who could stay, you know, with whom they could continue long into the future. And she found him and basically settled down.
Mary's first husband, the lawyer Julian Beatty, was increasingly abusive before coming out as gay and going his own way. But she writes quite eloquently about the appeal of other gay men, like lyricist Marshall Bearer. How did she explain that appeal, in his case and gay guys in general?
Well, she liked me. But she says in the book, everyone should marry a gay man at least once. She points out that, you know, for someone of her generation, she had a lot in common with gay men at that time. She, you know, couldn't really be herself the way she saw herself. She felt it was socially stigmatized. She was being pigeonholed in terms of what were appropriate interests for someone like her. She felt a great deal in common with gay men in general. And in particular, because she was the number one driver of her affection in life was talent. You know, in the theater, a lot of talent is associated for whatever reason with gay people. And when you imprint at an early age on Stephen Sondheim as your love object, which is what happened to her when she was 13, it sort of sets the stamp for the rest of your life.
Well, let's talk more about the biggest surprise to many readers may be her not quite unrequited love for Sondheim, who'd been her pal since they were kids. Talk about their relationship and what was supposed to be a, quote, trial marriage after what she calls her shit or get off the pot letter.
Well, they had been very close. They met at when she was 13 and he was 14 at Oscar Hammerstein's farm, as I said, in Bucks County. He played two or three games of chess with her and knocked her off the board. I mean, she completely, you know, destroyed her. And then he ran to the piano and played Rhapsody in Blue or something. So she was like, and she went through a kind of youthful pining phase, you know, asking people, well, why hasn't he written to me? Won't he, you know, and then let that go. And then she found him again at Westport. And from then on, really until the day she died, they were very close friends and intimates in many different ways. So during their 20s, they worked together a lot. They tried to write, you know, they tried to figure out the market and write songs for the market. There's a famous song they wrote called The Boy From, you know, which was for a show called The Mad Show, which was sort of taking the Calypso trend of that time and applying
The Girl from Ipanema.
And the Girl from Ipanema. So there was that kind of intimacy. There's a scene in which he kind of tells her he's gay. What makes this scene is that it's happening while they're sitting on the floor in her parents' house underneath her father's piano. You know, many of us have had coming out scenes. Very few of us have had them underneath that piano. So, but they and they vacation together. They play Sondheim's famous game nights. She was always part of that, although not the anagram part. She didn't like the anagrams. She called the anagram players the killer bees. And there's a whole sequence of games they play, which are detailed in the first chapter of the book, including one very characteristic called hostilities. But at some point between her, at the end of the interregnum, as she called it, between her two marriages, she wrote this shit or get off the pot letter to Sondheim. They've been sort of toying around with the idea of whether they should try to have more of a relationship than just as the very, very closest of friends, despite the obvious arguments against it. And to her surprise, he said, I mean, in so many words, let's try it. And they did try it. Didn't work.
She says, as you know, that he thought no other man was good enough for her.
Yes, and that was part of what annoyed her. I mean, every person she dated, he would say, oh, he's not smart enough, or, oh, he's boring, or he doesn't know music. Or, and so it was partly out of that, thank you for reminding me, that she said, all right then, how about you? Although, you know, the thing was, they couldn't figure out how to make a real marriage out of that. And it's an excruciating scene, if I say so myself. And they eventually understood that it wasn't to be, and they did remain friends, as I say, for the rest of their life, or her life. And at her memorial service, the most moving moment in that service, or that event, was his playing a song at the piano, no words, that he had written for her, based on a song they wrote together in their early 20s.
In Sag Harbor, she was charmed by the gay playwright and AIDS activist Larry Kramer, even excusing his public attack on her after an appearance at the Bay Street Theater there. And quite revealing about her as well. Tell us about that.
Well, this has to do with Arthur Lawrence, also, the little shit.
Oh, good.
Arthur and Mary were friends, very, very close for many years, but part of that from Mary's side was fear of becoming one of his enemies. There are people who keep you as their friends because they seem to threaten what will happen if you don't. And everyone I know who has, you know, had that situation with him, including myself, not as a friend but as a journalist, knows that it can be terrifying when he decides that you're off the list. So she feels, though, that it was a moral failing on her part, that she tolerated him for so long, even watching as he destroyed other people. And she felt like she likened herself to a collaborator in Vichy France. She quickly said, not like the kind, you know, like Marshall Bear or collaborator. Was already, by the point of this story, unsure about Arthur and could she get away from her friendship with him. He said he was her son's godfather. She says he was not. She said, we are Jews, we don't really have godfathers. And if he had a godfather, because his middle name is Arthur, might it not be because his grandfather's name was Arthur? Hank's father was named Arthur. So that was another Lawrence lie, according to Mary. Anyway, they go to see, they go with Arthur and his partner, and Larry and his partner, she and Hank, go to dinner in Sag Harbor at a fish restaurant. We never found out the name of the fish restaurant. And then they go to hear Larry speak at the Bay Street Theater, and he was in his high dudgeon, you know, if any of you ever got to hear Larry spiel, it's quite an astonishing performance, and heartfelt. At the end, Mary got up, there were questions, and Mary raised her hand and said, you know, what can we do to help? And he let loose on her, like, how can you, the daughter of Richard Rodgers and the heir to billions of dollars, which is not true, you know, ask that question, give money, why aren't you giving money? You should be giving until her, whatever, you know, along those lines. And then, as she says, little Arthur got up on his little feet and tried to defend her. And it was in that moment somehow that she reversed and she saw that Larry was right and Arthur was wrong. She didn't want to be defended against a true charge. Not that she had billions to spend, but to ask what can I do when you have the means to do something was a kind of narrow thing to say. And she and Larry became extremely close. And she and Arthur broke up.
Well, whoever his godfather was, soon after Adam's birth, she let a friend of mine hold him and predicted quite presciently that he would come much closer to her father's musical genius than she ever did. But later, she admits to having some problems with Adam's style of music in a way like her daddy did with hers.
I see what you're saying, but she adored his music. She just didn't understand it. He went so much further than she had done. Although, if you're fortunate enough ever to hear some of the later things she wrote, they are astoundingly beautiful and very much moving forward into what sounds a little like Adam Gettle's music, highly chromatic, not resolved, and rhythmically, you know, still retaining a Richard Rodgers kind of bass, so that you know where you are. She was very keen in music on letting the ear know where it is and that it's going to get back home. But she began to take further and further journeys in between to get there, and it's very beautiful. So Adam's music, you know, basically omits the bass. I'm using bass in both senses here. Omits the kind of understructure that tells you where you are in many cases, and just takes the journeys. And she found it hard to understand, but she loved it. But, you know, she also worried about him. He made some of the same mistakes she made, not getting the rights nailed down before you start the show. And there's a kind of wonderful scene when The Light in the Piazza is up for a Tony Award for Best Musical, among other things. He'd already won for Best Score, but it was the moment when Best Musical was going to be announced. And she was sitting in the row behind him, and he leans over just as they're about to call the winner, and he says, "I love you, Mom." And she says, "It's going to be Spamalot." Spamalot. And she was right.
Adam's dad and her second husband for 52 years, Hank Gettle, she makes no mention of gay appeal. But some people who knew them say he too was at least bisexual. Could that be one of the tell-it-all, quote, but what we can't exclusions that she stipulated?
If it were, would I tell you?
No. Okay, well, I just had to ask.
Good effort.
More generally about writing this book, what were your talk sessions like? Where did they take place, for how long, with or without liquid refreshment? Did you bring specific questions or general topics? Was it exhausting or exhilarating?
I'm going to answer that. I just want to say, in terms of what was left out, in this book you get between 95 and 98% of the truth, of the whole truth and nothing but the truth. That is a really good bargain. I challenge you to find a memoir that does that, especially from someone situated as she was. I'm not defending myself, I'm defending her, because I, you know, it's understandable people want to know, well, what really happened with Arthur Lawrence, and what, you know, and I know, as many people in the theater know some of it, I won't talk about it. There were just these few things she felt were not hers to tell. If it had only affected her, she would talk about it as much as I wanted. But if it strongly impacted another person, living person, she wasn't, you know, in a way she couldn't account for or didn't feel that she could take the responsibility for, she, those things were omitted. Now, to answer your question, it was a highlight of my life to sit with her for those, a little bit more than 2 years, twice a week, 4 hours a day, plus then it would spill over into lunch when we would eat often with Hank, and the actual historical part of the work was not happening at those lunches, but a lot of other things were happening, just particularly getting the voice drilled into my head. And I would show up at 9 a.m. in the yellow room, the living room of their apartment on Central Park West, and the help would bring in my tea and cookies, and she would be sitting there perfectly erect with a pencil, which was never once used. And I had my laptop. I did not record anything. I typed everything as we spoke. We knew what we wanted and didn't want by that. We had already spoken for years about what the book could be and shouldn't be. The delay before we started had to do with her changing her mind 10 times and having to, you know, get the contract rewritten and all that. But by the time we started, we had a pretty good sense of especially what it would not be. She really hated her parents' memoirs. Each of them, her father had written one and her mother had written three. And she felt they were basically fantasies and dull. And she also hated, and then I wrote books. She didn't want it to be chronological. There were a million things that it shouldn't be, and we had pretty much figured that out by the time I spoke, so we just talked. And then I would go home, and I would say, what? Really? That, what? And I would start looking into, like, these things she would tell me, like, when she converted to Catholicism, and was, her father was blackmailed by Walter Winchell not to report that this had happened. You know, but everything, I would do a lot of checking, and there was almost nothing that didn't check out really exactly. If there were slight fixes, and they're noted in the notes.
Just a few more. You know that...
We have a few minutes for some questions, if you'd let us.
Well, let me ask this last one then. You know that Mary only got to read the first few pages about those games she played with family and friends before her death in 2014 at age 83. Talk about your anxiety, or how she would react, and how she finally did. Her last words to you.
I had sent her the first 10 pages. She had read them, and when I next showed up, she had them printed out, and this time there were pencil marks. I couldn't see the pencil marks. She wasn't showing it to me. And she said, I don't know, it's not real, but something's wrong. And we talked for a while, and in the end she said, make it funnier, make it meaner. And I said, Mary, the first chapter of the book is called Hostilities.
about her last words to you when you saw her for the last time, about tears, which are heart and touching.
It's a little hard to explain because of the way the book takes a structural turn there, but... at the very end, our work sessions had stopped. She was basically about to go into hospice care. She was in the hospital, and we spoke on the phone, and she could hear that I was crying, and she was like, cut that out. The last words she said to me were, didn't we have fun? And what she meant by make it funnier, make it meaner, was that she wanted the reader to have a great time. And she didn't mean nasty. She just meant, like, push it as far as you can, so that they can have the experience of life that she had. And with that permission, I eventually went, all right, let's go. And I wrote the rest of it.
Jesse Green, thank you. Now it's time for...
Sondheim, it would have happened long before. I mean, they knew each other since West Side Story.
By the time of the piano.
Yeah, but I don't doubt the story, and certainly being close to Arthur was like being close to a nuclear plant.
Nuclear plant.
You would get the radiation.
Pina.
Since she had such a very strange childhood, what was she like as a parent?
A very strange parent. She was absolutely adamant to do nothing the way that it had been done in her family. And so she was very free, you know, and she taught her children all the curse words deliberately so that they would know them, and then just talked with them about when you say these words and when you don't, but that there's nothing that's forbidden.
What about the love part?
She made sure the boys had condoms at a very early age. She was, you know, very open about all of that. No, she was in many ways a great mother, but you would have to talk to her children. Five of her six children are alive. They are all incredible people, so you would have to say that she and her husbands, even her first husband, who their marriage is bad, but that doesn't mean he was a bad father. And I think they feel that there was, you know, there were maybe too many times from a child's point of view when she wasn't there, which was exactly the compromise she knew she had to make. She was working, or she was, or she dragged them along to Tamamen. They were at Tamamen while she worked 20 hours a day, and, you know, they were in the swamp somewhere trying to swim. So I think they have a more nuanced point of view, but from the outside, I looked at her as a parent and I thought, yeah, I would take that.
And what is the family's reaction to the book that they had no control over?
Well, they were fabulous in terms of that. They understood that that was the constraint that their mother put on it. They thought it was typical. And they were, you know, they didn't try to interfere. And then when they read it, they were very, you know, of course they have different points of view on it, and it's very strange for them to read their mother's, in their mother's voice, discussions of all the affairs she had, and, you know, and how she thought about them as children, things they didn't even know. The children of the first marriage did not know that their father had been violent with Mary. So there were a lot of shocks. But, you know, the fact that they are all supportive of the book is all I need, that they feel funny about it or disagree with certain things or would have done it differently. I look forward to them doing so because they could all write a pretty great book themselves. Well, as I say, I had already written. Oh, she asked how Mary's instruction to make it funnier and make it meaner impacted the work I did after she died, which was, you know, 95% of the book. And as I said, I was kind of at first kind of baffled by the instruction. But as I came to write more and more, I realized that it freed me up. I felt like I could jump around in order to create effects in the writing. So we would talk about something, the same story might come up four different times over the course of 2.5 years, and, you know, I had to find ways to put that together into one story, and I felt free to use my own humor, as informed by my knowledge of hers, to tell it in the most amusing possible way. What I thought to myself was, how would I make Mary laugh? Using her own stories and what I've typed here. And if instead of worrying about, am I quoting exactly the way she said it, I didn't even bother with that anymore. I just tried to create the thing that that she would laugh at. And when we would be talking, I would say something in response to something she said, and she would laugh, and she would say, put that in. I'm like, well, how? I mean, I just put it in.
Go ahead.
Loving music and such sophisticated music could be this kind of person as well?
Tom? Well, the question is whether it was surprising that Richard Rodgers, having written such beautiful and emotional music, could also be this kind of nasty cult figure. And sadly, having been around show business for a very long time, the answer is no, it did not surprise me. I will say, though, the book does tell you enough about his upbringing so that you can understand how music became his way of expressing better part of himself.
All right, my last request. Mary's response when you tried to pay a bill after a meal.
Well, not just to me, anyone.
That sentence.
Basically.
I love that. My favorite line in the book, perhaps.
She says, when your father writes Oklahoma, you can take the check. I want to tell you, when I told my father that, he was pissed off.
That's a great thing.